still we are working for a limited time. This is the time when we can start building relationships with our children and make the time we spend with them fun time with the children to look forward to. Make them feel loved, secure, and you know, you should set aside time. It doesn't mean that you need hours and hours, because not that when we are at home, we are just sitting idle. Most of us are working from home. But parents, even if you give 20 minutes in a day to your child, where you give your 100% attention, I think that is really beneficial for the child and you also. Set aside, I think the parents, most of the parents are becoming very prescriptive. They want to prescribe, hey, better do this, do that, do it this way. We do not give the opportunity to children to experiment, to explore, or even to make choices. That's a small thing. So we need to give that opportunity to children where they can make choices. We have to ask them, what would you like to talk about? What would you want to play? And when we are interacting with them, you know, we need to switch off the TVs and phones. Virus-free time has to be there. And when we say you have to listen to them, please make sure that you are looking in their eyes. You are looking at them. You are, you know, giving them some emotional expressions. Your body language is also talking. That will make it fun and that will make the connect stronger. This these days is structure up. That is, you know, making a routine. When children were going to schools, they were in a timetable mode. They were in a structure where flow of the day was planned. And totally, you know, each thing one after other was planned for them. But I would suggest parents, when they are at home with you, please make sure that at home also there is a structure to look forward to. If you will condition them with a structure, children will be more organized, they will be more manageable, and definitely more happier. So find when the brain develops to the maximum. So we need to take out time where they do something where their physical activity is involved. And definitely, you know, physical, cognitive, their academics, everything should be part of their daily routine. Hand washing and hygiene should be fun for them. They have to learn. We have to train them into, you know, all those habits. I think is definitely in these times, children might be behaving badly or maybe not appropriately at times. Kabhi they are tired, sometimes they are bored, they are hungry, they are afraid. There can be so many reasons for them to go crazy and, you know, really trouble us. But then in such times, as a parent, what you need to do is, the first thing, I'll give you this, you know, small tool. First is redirect. Redirect where you have to stop the behavior before it starts. If you see the child is, you know, trying to become a little messy or trying to really get into a different mode, please distract your child to a more constructive activity. Distract your child to something better, something good, something positive. And if you feel like shouting on the child, screaming or doing something, take a pause. Give yourself just few seconds, maybe 20 seconds, to think about how you are responding and why. What is the trigger? What is, you know, pushing you to shout and scream? That will not work. Take a pause, and I think it really works with, you know, parents. The third thing I would suggest is use consequences. They really work very nice. But before you use consequences, what you should do first is give them a choice of agreeing to your instruction or not agreeing. If they don't agree, they don't want to agree, please use consequences. And when I talk about consequences, it does not mean that punishment and things like that. But yes, withdrawal of privileges, I think, is the best thing that can be done with children. But you know, in this stressful time, the most important thing is that you need to be calm, you need to be composed, you have to manage your stress first and then the child's stress. And for that, what you can do is, first you have to understand the whole world is with you. You are not alone going through such times. Definitely for parents, it is financially, it is, you know, related to your professionally, in all respects we have got a, you know, hit. But then we have to take a break and think about it. We have to listen to our children. We have to take a pause where we internalize and talk about it. When I say thing, my most important thing is learning through play. And parents, nowadays, so much research is going on this word play, because play is missing. I would like to tell you, when we were small, you would be also knowing. You would have played in the mud, in the sand, you would have played in the water. But now if somebody has to play, you know, if they let you play in the water, they say it is hydrotherapy. If a child plays in mud, it is called mud therapy. So imagine, those have become so therapeutic, but they came naturally to us. So this is the time when we can involve and engage our children to the ground games. I think Ludos and Caroms have come out with in all the homes. People are engaging in those activities, but yet playing with mud, playing actually, you know, things like Stapu and whatnot, I think those are very important things where you have movement games, you have sitting games, you have cognitive games, you have your team games, you have different kinds of games, memory games, and you sing with them, dance with them, engage with them meaningfully. That is very important. Learning does not happen only through books. Books are one of the mediums where learning can happen. But believe me, if you engage them nicely, you can turn the whole house into a lab, into a learning laboratory. Taking care of yourself is very important, and I thoroughly believe that.
Right, I was at a moment.
Yeah, yeah. Somebody has to be on mute. I really believe that self-love is very important. A person who cannot love self cannot give love. So you need to take care of yourself, not only by loving yourself. Self-love creates a very positive self-image. But then to engage yourself also meaningfully, you can get into different, hobbies. You can paint. And I think in COVID, there are so many chefs, so many artists, so many writers who have come out. And there are people who never knew themselves, who had never internalized, who had never explored their own talents. They have come out with talents. So you have to engage yourself first into something meaningful, something creative, so that your children be with you. And since they are with you, they will see and learn. I think if our parents, so many studies, I am wondering how people are so quick, you know. The lockdown happened and the corona happened, and they are like, the whole, plethora of researchers are here, and they are doing so many beautiful researches. So this is also done in Melbourne. It is so beautiful. I really loved it, you know. And definitely, I think this is so nice. That we always say in Hindi ki do bartan rehte to aapas mein khadakte zarur. So that is what it is, that families self-isolating together can bring the worst out in each other. When we are fighting, we will fight, we will do everything. But how we can keep it amicable is that they say that don't become a shark, a turtle or a fox. Become a penguin, a teddy bear or an owl. So it is how you communicate. A shark is generally, very success-oriented, very success-oriented. A shark style of communication is very aggressive. The shark is very angry, very disagreeable. I think sometimes in emergencies or in exigencies, it is okay to become a shark. It is important, in fact, to become a shark. But generally in the routine life, good communication is not shark-like communication. And if I talk about a turtle is so self-protected. A turtle is always withdrawn. So हम नहीं चाहेंगे हमारा बच्चा कुछ बोले ही नहीं हमें हमेशा कुछ भी है तो मन में ही रखे. You won't like to be with people like this, and we don't want to train our children to be like this. And today's world, when they have to speak about themselves, they have to raise a voice for themselves. Nobody is there to stand with you. So in these days, turtles are very self-protective, and it is a very unhelpful kind of communication, I say. And turtles would never, come out. They will be very, very protective about themselves. And in that protection, they would not want to engage in communication with others. When we talk about foxes are very dismissive. Foxes create a lot of... Okay, shall I continue?
Yes, tell yes, ma'am, please.
Okay. So foxes are very dismissive. Foxes are, very, very confusing. They create confusions while they're talking. So I think that is also not a good way of talking. So then we come to, the best people whom we can learn, the best beings whom we can learn to communicate are penguins, teddy bears and owls. Penguins are very chirpy. Whatever, they want to talk it out, they reason out things. They question a lot, they seek answers, and they are always very pro at communicating and talking out things. And I think that is the way it should be. We always say that sometimes, we don't talk and the things are not done. And most of the times, if you talk, there is a 50% chance that half of the things would be done, have 50% chance of getting a yes from others. So we need to teach our children to reason out, to question, to answer properly, and talk aloud about any discussion, anything that they, you know, think should be talked about. And when I talk about, you know, teddy bears are very, very empathetic. They are so loving. Empathetic means that, yes, they will understand what the other person is going through, and then they will strategize what they need to talk. And they are loving. And I think that is also a beautiful thing, strategy that we can learn from them. Owls are, again, very intelligent. Owls do a lot of, you know, they want to get into a lot of compromises, and they generally do not talk much, but they want to get into a lot of kind of trading with you, you know, that if you do this, I will do that, if you do this, I will do that. And they are, they don't impose what they want, but then they create, facilitate the atmosphere and the surrounding in a way that you come up to them and you start talking to them. So I think owl also teaches us a very wonderful strategy. Again, this Terry Bowles did another study which I really enjoy, you know. So this is done by that person. But then Jennifer Lansford said this: that starting from infancy, children learn grammar, vocabulary, and comprehension better when you talk with them than if you are just passively listening. So as I told you, know, if we engage the children in to and fro conversation, it is always better. We think that children would learn if they are listening, because we are used to that they are around and they would pick up. But believe me, if they pick up passively, they are not so good at it. But yes, if we engage them in talking, literal terms, talking, then it is definitely better. In that perspective, your children are small, so this is a very beautiful example, you know. Not that, again, I would say don't be prescriptive. Don't talk to your children about what you want to talk to them about. Ask them what do they want to listen or what do they want to talk about. Institute in Melbourne, again, it is called Berry Street Childhood Institute. They came up with a very beautiful score that a good childhood is characterized by stable, responsive, caring relationships in families and in the community. Children thrive in nurturing environments that encourage them to explore and engage safely with the world around them and support them to fulfill their potential. So I think basic agenda should be to make our children happy, competent, and competitive. Competitive does not mean that they have to ride on the other person's head and, you know, win the competition, but we have to learn them, we have to teach them to build up beautiful relationships around them. Nowadays, if you see a person who has very good IQ, who is very intelligent, I think is not as successful as a person who has good SQ and EQ, who is good socially, who is good emotionally. I think people who have good SQs and EQs are employing people who have good IQs. And it is commonly seen. So parents, it is very important for you to let them explore and experiment. Let them have hands-on learning in everything. And always trust in them. Trust their potential. All five fingers cannot be equal. All children cannot be same. So please do not compare your child with anybody. Your children are a gift of God to you, and they have come with their own set of destiny. But yes, you are very, very instrumental in, you know, forming their destiny, especially in these formative years. In these formative years, the more encouraging you are, the more, you know, enriching experiences and positive experiences that you can give to your children would benefit them. You should give a past that they can smile on. You should give them a time when they grow up, if they think about you or they think about the time they spent with you, they should be happy feeling that and proud feeling, you know, recollecting their memories. They should be sharing what you and how you interacted with them to their children when they grow up. And I think I can go on and on and on with this for 2 days also. So I need to give myself a halt somewhere. Before I talk about this, I would say that I think Vijay Ma'am would have shared a Google form with you. That's a feedback form. I would love that if all of you can spare 2 minutes and share that form, fill up that form and share it back so that I get it. So one mantra, one basic thing that I would like to end the note on is that this is, you know, something that Dalai Lama has said. Give the ones you love wings to fly and roots to come back and reasons to stay. And I think you should understand that, that if you keep your children grounded, if you keep your children, if you tell them the difference between needs and wants, if you give them a good value system, you will always keep them grounded. And if they're grounded, if their roots are strong, they will grow. So roots are to grow. Only if the roots are strong, they will grow in this world. If the roots are weak, they will not flourish. So give them those strong roots and let them experiment and let them explore the world around them. Give them opportunities to explore so that they can fly high. And then reasons to stay would be the reasons, would be the, you know, would be your attitude, would be the strategies that you use to engage with them, to involve them, and the attitude and aptitude you have as a parent would make them, would give them a reason to stay connected with you forever.
You have covered, in fact, most of the questions, most of it. You have already opened up the plethora of the learning domains for a child sitting at home. So what is more important right now, I think what I really want to add is into it, when we are giving up this device, it should be really used up as a device, whether it's an iPad, whether it's a laptop, or it's a mobile. It should really not be, I humbly request all the parents that it should not be used as a toy or a remote. Very just because that's what Vinita ji wanted to say, that they should really maintain their posture. If they maintain their gait and their posture when they are using those devices 100%, then some learning is going on. If at all they use it as a remote or it's like a toy, then they will be using it up very frequently. They would just be using it up like a toy to amuse them. Amusement also is necessary, but 100% learning. It's a toy. That's why what Vinita, you told us about the Washington Press, that how many researches are going on, and 2 hours of seeing up, and that is what schools are also trying to do. 1 hour screen time for smaller bachchas, and 2 to 2.5 hours for bada students. So at home also, minimize curfew time. What you have used the word is a perfect word. Curfew of the media. Let's not have it. Now, one last question, Vinita, before we all leave. Now, when they all come back to us in the school, I as a principal and as educators and all my teachers, we're all a little concerned about the structure of a school. These children might have forgotten the simulation the teacher used to give them in the learning. That also, the social equation and the bonding that they have. How will we as teachers really give them back to them? You know, that timing, that 8 to 2, yes, I have to go to school, I have to be in school. Because right now, I think every day, every particular time or an hour is a school time for them or learning with parents. So how will we disconnect them from the house to school?
Jyoti, that is the reason I was talking. I really stressed upon, you know, structuring and making routine plans for their children. So it is, you know, on the parents to engage them meaningfully and structure them, condition them, make a checklist and help them, you know, do all those things in those timings, in the timings that are appropriately given. So that once this transition is over, children are back to school, it is easy for them to engage. Otherwise, you know, in households, I've seen children are waking up at 10, 11, parents are sleeping late, children are also sleeping late. So please, parents, keep a fixed time of sleeping and waking up as you used to do it when they were going to school. And after that, you know, as the children were going to school, let them freshen up on time, let them shower and dress up, and dress up means they can dress up as they are home, but then you can plan their activities that, you know, this half an hour you're going to play carom, this half an hour you're going to draw, this half an hour you are free, do anything, give them free time also. This these few minutes you can watch something on the TV, these few minutes, you know, you can engage with me in a conversation, these few minutes are for dancing, depending on what the child wants to do and does not want to do. But it will be better if the parents ask the children how, and you know, plan with the child. Like I said, I really love that thing, you know, don't be prescriptive. So ask the children how they want to be engaged, but tell them you have to follow a timetable from say 8 to 12, but then you have the choice to make. You can decide what activities you want to fill in here. So that will keep them in a structure and the transition would be very smooth.
Yeah. So on that particular note, I think all our parents must be really feeling very enlightened today in this time when they all are very anxious and there's so much of curiosity to know that when this COVID is going to finish and when we all are going to join back school. Yes, school is 100% which every child looks forward to, and every teacher also looks forward where the children come back to us. So thank you so much on this note, Vanita, and we'll keep meeting and keep sharing such lovely views with you. Keep sharing your thoughts, and I'm sure the parents are going to reflect on it and make their this journey of COVID something very positive with all of them within their own parent community. Thank you so much from all of us at Manasvi.